I'm Sampath, as Rishabh said. I'm working at Amazon right now, and I'm working in the field of computer vision and deep learning. I studied at CMU before. I took my master's from CMU, and prior to CMU, I worked at Synopsys and graduated from Bitspirani in India. So this is my short intro. I can come to my profile. But prior to that, I would say for masters, it's always very, very much variable. We never know what the university is looking for, and it's the overall profile that matters. So the some universities do look for GRE scores, more stricter than the other universities, and some universities doesn't care about GRE scores that much. They do care, but not that seriously. But still look for some other things in your profile more. So coming to my profile, I would say I might not have a strong GPA, but I do have a couple of years work experience in Synopsys back in India after my bachelor's. So I had my bachelor's from Bitspilani, and I do have some couple of strong courses that I did in my bachelor's, and I had some nice strong letters of recommendations from my professors in Bitspilani. I feel they have helped me a lot, and the way that you write your statement of purpose is very, very helpful too. So I think these are the things that helped me secure an admit in CMU. It's mostly regarding researching about the divisions, like departments that you want to go into and the programs. So most of the times you'll come through your friends to understand, okay, this university has a really nice program in so-and-so field. And you make a list of some, like I had a list of like 8 universities, and I made a list of those 8 universities, and initially the list was longer, and then boiled down them to like 6 to 8 universities, and then apply to those universities. So basically it's it comes down to discussing with your friends, discussing with your seniors regarding what programs are good and what's your interest in, and then finalizing the universities. So my priority was mainly to learn, and I felt like a job will follow, just like that. So I did not frankly keep in mind, okay, this university will fetch my job or not. So it was mainly regarding whether I learn well or not. So I'm sure, like, if you land up in a nice university where the teaching is good, the jobs will definitely follow. Frankly saying, like, I started out my career as a computer architecture person. So I had my courses in computer architecture and Bitspilani, and my bachelor's was all around like computer architecture, and my experience in Synopsys was in computer architecture. And so I went into CMU with a strong background in computer architecture. So, but then later on, once I went into CMU while I was doing my computer architecture courses, I was pulled towards data science and machine learning fields. So I started off doing those courses as well. And so that's where the switch happened, actually. So for people who are interested in switching, or like not sure whether you want to switch, or like how to switch, I would say, like, you can see my path as like one example where I started off with computer architecture, but went into all these fields where I was interested in. I was not sure whether I'm interested in that or not. CMU gave me the chance to switch directions. So, like, I'm sure, like, most people here know, like, how hard the field of machine learning and deep learning is right now. But the interest that I found is that, like, the way that deep learning solves the problems, the way how challenging the field is, and the way that the field is so much evolving right now, interested me a lot. And while I say that, like, people, every person do have their own interest, and you should find your own interest in a similar way. I had one of my friends who studied at CMU, and he also kind of switched his fields from initially in electronics to cloud computing. So that's when I felt like, yeah, I should definitely apply to CMU and take a chance to switch directions. And luckily, I landed up with the admit and got the chance. So it's common among like the top universities, at least. But it's not that everyone does that. But it's a feature that I like the most because I made use of that. But nevertheless, CMU is really, really good for computer architecture too. So there are really good professors with whom I worked in the initial days of my CMU. And even through I studied like for 3 semesters in CMU, and 2 semesters I still did a lot of computer architecture courses. So I had a good rapport with some professors there. I did some PhD level courses at CMU in computer architecture too. So that's a really good one, but my interests were on the other side. So I just wanted to try it out and just switch fields. So it depends on the person totally. I did around like 2 RAs in during my time at CMU. So 1 RA was in computer architecture, and the other RA was in the deep learning field. So my first RA was with Microsoft project. So it's a project related to Microsoft data centers. Microsoft is using some things like FPGAs in the data centers, and the project was called Catapult. So I was working with that project to explore what could be done with that thing, and exploring the FPGAs in data centers paradigm. And my second area was in deep learning field. So I was trying to do image captioning from videos. So that was a really interesting problem. That still needs to be solved a lot. So we could achieve something, but as everyone can know, the field is evolving right now, and it's very intriguing to find new solutions right now. So it's mostly getting in touch with the professors. So I see most of the people do one mistake regarding. People say, yeah, I'm really serious about getting an RA or TA, but one mistake everyone do is not getting in touch with professors. So first step is to mail the professors, get in touch with them formally, write the proper, compose a proper mail, attach your resume, make sure they see that, and also go and contact them in person. So the in-person thing is where professors, like the number of people boil down at the in-person meeting. So not everyone will go in person, but almost like a lot of people just drop a mail. So in that case, professors do think that, okay, dropping in person is definitely one extra step that you can take. So you can take that one. Or if your resume is stellar, probably the professor will look at the resume and give you a internship through email itself. So regarding part-time jobs, it's mostly regarding try finding what you want to do. So mostly, most people want to go for some RAs or TAs. And if you think that that's a little too much of work on like education, like, and if you want to try out something else, like being a librarian or something, you can approach them too. But yeah, in almost every such scenario, it's mostly getting in touch with the person. Like if you want a job somewhere, not just drop a mail, but just go in person and talk with them. So most of the times it's about networking, and most of the times it's about going in person and talking with them. Yeah, don't worry, like most of the times you can get a job whenever you want. Like if you are in the right place and if you get in touch with the right people. So my internship was in the same team that I'm working in right now. So I secure. So usually in most of the, even the top universities in the US, it's mostly, it's when you say on-campus jobs, it's mostly about the companies come to a career fair in the campus, and you can talk with the companies and you can pass on the resume to the people from the companies. And once you pitch them your resume, and once they like it, they note your points down and call you for interview or like go ahead in that process. So in a similar situation, our company also came to the career fair. I spoke with the people who came to the career fair, and yeah, they happened to like my resume, and yeah, most of the times it's the same scenario. And some of the people can also find jobs or internships through mailing the HRs or getting a referral from through friends or seniors. So these are the two major sources of getting an internship or jobs in the US. So I see that going on right now. So I'm not, so most of the times I think there are situations that they want to deal with, and I think they only deal with the scenarios where like there could be a lot of illegal residents too, so they might be dealing with them first, and not like if you really want to come into the US, and if you really have the credentials and everything, I don't see why the US or like any country trying to deny you the visa or trying to deny you the higher education. So I think it's mostly in the cases where the candidate is not probably worth going in, or I don't know, like I can't really comment on what they are trying to do, but at least I see right now it's going well. So it's not as scary a situation as probably people are thinking. So it's better put it, try finding your seniors and you'll get a really good sense, like, okay, rather than some stranger saying, if you hear it from your seniors, I think you will really try to understand, okay, this is not as scary as I thought. So I can assure you guys, like, this is not as scary as the Indian media probably is projecting right now. I see my mom saying the same thing, like, oh, everyone kept saying, oh, H-1B visas are getting into a bad situation and all. But no, I don't see that right now, at least. So Prodigy Finance was really helpful in that direction, as to like, I may not, my choice of choosing the university after I got my admit would have changed if Prodigy was not there. So, but while I say that, like, I never thought of any financial reasons before applying, because I just did not want my financial criteria to affect my admits or something. So it's mostly I would say, like, first decide on your universities, and if finance is the top criterion, then take that into consideration. But if you have a nice university in your hand, probably an option like Prodigy Finance can come in, and yeah, you can get a finance from that too. The universities here are really expensive, but most of the nice top universities that are private are very really good. So once you get a job, like, you can really finish up your loan very soon. So, and if you're not in a private university, probably other universities are like decently inexpensive. So I think in that case also you can get over your loan very soon. So my Prodigy Finance experience was really, really good. So that's why, like, I do need to go to work right now, but I am still in the webinar to make sure, like, yeah, people probably would want to take the right decision too. So I would say, like, when I did not need to think much about financials before applying for MS universities, I'm really happy now that I made that decision, because probably CMU is really expensive, so probably CMU might have gone down on my list if I thought about my finances. So having an admit and then seeing that Prodigy Finance is an option, I am really happy that I could go to CMU or like I could use Prodigy option for that. So definitely I would recommend Prodigy Finance for that. And without a collateral or without a cosigner, I think that's a really good option that I frankly explored a lot of options in India, like financial options in India. So I myself can really say that there's no other option that compelled me so much that Prodigy Finance did. So I definitely recommend Prodigy.